Tonight we want to talk about something that I think that you'll find to be interesting as well as somewhat challenging to some of the kind of things that we hear. How many of you, or let's say, what do you think when someone says the word consequences to you? Consequences. How does that make you feel when you hear the word consequences? Well, you know, those laughs of recognition are pretty interesting because when people hear consequences, they think of something that's negative. But you realize that consequences are as positive as they are negative. They're no more negative than they are positive. The difference is that between those two things is just what God has given us, and that's choice. To be able to live in between my consequences or my consequences. But everything has consequences. Bad things, of course, have bad consequences. And some of us have experienced some of those things, but good things have good consequences just as well. You see, life is filled with a number of different laws that govern us. There are things that govern everything that we do, whether we realize it or whether we don't. There are these invisible things or laws that govern life. One of such law is really the law of gravity. You don't really realize, but gravity really kind of governs everything. You're able to walk on the ground. You're able to actually jump off a table, if that's what you want to do. You can jump up and down, and people are actually judged or celebrated over high that they can really defy the law of gravity. That's how they're defined, on how high that they can get off the ground, having really defied that law, which governs us. Actually, even in martial arts, really people who've done martial arts understand that really the law of gravity is the law that is always obeyed. You don't really do anything off balance. You make sure that you have your center of gravity in its correct place, and then you can actually use your power from that place of gravity. You know, everything, like I said, has consequences. Some good, some bad, some indifferent. But remember this, you and I being prisoners of time, we actually are able to count the successes or the failures of our consequences. You know, here's the oldest joke in all of history. A guy goes into the doctor's office, right? And when he goes into the doctor's office, he says, "Doctor," he says, "it hurts when I do that." What did the doctor say? "Don't do that." So it's the same with life. Quit doing it. If something hurts, stop it. Now, talking about consequences, it's pretty interesting, is that God actually spoke to the serpent. Now, let me just ask you a question. What did the serpent say that was so wrong? I mean, really. He said to the girl, he says to her, he says, did God say that you won't eat of every tree in the garden? She said, we're not going to eat of any tree of the garden. And the tree that's in the middle of the garden, God told us not to eat it. Neither should we touch it, lest we die. And he said, God didn't say that you would die. He didn't lie. But God said to him, he says, you know what? You led that person. You led them into a place that brought consequences. He said, so there's consequences for what you do. Now, you have to understand consequences. Much like the consequence of gravity, of jumping out of an airplane without a parachute, you know, just a whole bunch of things that defy that law, the same way that those things happen are the same way that God speaks. He didn't speak like, I'm really mad at you, and because I'm mad at you, this is what you get. He didn't do that. What God did was he let them know what would happen. You go here, this is what happens. You go there, this is what happens. You know, if what you do is that you keep going to places that do things that you don't want to do, guess what happens? What happened? What's the consequence of going where you don't want to do the things that are done there? What are the consequences? You start doing them. So guess what? Just like at the doctor's office, don't go there. It's that simple. You want to avoid the consequences of it, then don't go there. It's real simple. There are consequences in every situation that we're in. If what you do is that you live your life with a husband that actually, basically, he wants to tell you about how great of a Christian that he is, and what he does is he actually does everything as a non-Christian, but it's telling you how great it is, and he doesn't speak words of love. He actually speaks words of manipulation, control, and hatred, yet he's trying to hold you to something that he himself doesn't do. What is he? What consequence does he get? Does he get a wife that is everything that God wants her to be? He doesn't. As a matter of fact, what he gets is the very thing that he spoke to. He spoke into manipulation and control. Guess what he gets? Manipulated, and he gets controlled. When he speaks to her with words of hatred instead of words of love, she will outwardly express words of love because she wants the relationship to continue, but inwardly, she's becoming more bitter every day. She gets the consequence of it. So the same way that at the doctor's office, then just don't go where you don't want to go. And what he told the serpent was this. In Genesis chapter 4, Genesis 3, verse 14. So the Lord God said to the serpent, because you've done this. Because you've done this. That's as far as I want to go with it. He said, because you have done this, this is what happens. He then goes to the woman. And he says to the woman right from there, he says to her actually, he says, to the man. Let's go to the man first. Let's stay with the notes. He said then to the man in verse 17, he said then to Adam, he said, because you've heeded the voice of your wife. Because you've heeded a voice. Now, it's not so bad heeding the voice of your wife. As a matter of fact, in many things, Linda's a lot smarter than I am. That isn't even the question. But what happened was that when you go down for your answers instead of go up, there's consequences. When you ask the right question to the wrong person, there's consequences. She's not bad. She's awesome. But what happened to her? All of a sudden, God said to her, he said, now because you, next to the woman, actually, I may not even have her there. Stop that. I'm trying to remember this. So I'm giving you more things because I've thought more things since I wrote this. But to the woman, what he says this. He said, and because of what's happening with you, pain in childbirth is what you get. How many of you girls understand that? You get it? It can be painful. He said, that's what you get. He said, you remember this. That's what you get. Now, why did she get that? Because she listened to the wrong voice. Why did Adam get it? Because he listened to the wrong voice. Don't you remember when God actually came to Cain on the side of the road and he said to him, he said, Cain, he said, why are you so depressed? He said, if you do what's right, you'll get the right stuff. But if you don't do what's right, you won't get the right stuff. Because there are consequences to everything. But to us, in Galatians chapter 6, verse number 7, he said here, don't be deceived. He said, don't be deceived. Now remember, what did the serpent do in the beginning? He deceived her. So he said, now look, you, don't be deceived. You can't make a fool out of what God said. You can't. You can't change it. You can't just decide to gather all the opinions that you want to and then decide what you think is right. He said, don't be deceived. You can't make a fool out of God. He said, for whatever a man sows, that what? So consequences aren't bad. Consequences just are. Decisions are right, and decisions are not right. And whichever way that you fall off will determine the consequence that comes. So here, I want to give you a few things that really are the laws that govern life. They actually govern us. They govern our futures. They govern our relationships. They'll govern every part of what you know about. And so let's begin. Here's number one. It's the law of focus. In the law of focus here, we find that the law of focus tells us this. It says that your focus will inevitably determine your results. Whatever you focus on, that's ultimately what's going to bring you the results that you want or the results that you don't. But focus determines one thing or the other. What are you looking at? What gets your time? What gets your attention? Because your focus determines your results. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 4, beginning with verse 20, here God gives us these understandings. Now, one of the things that we have to realize about our relationship with God is that God created us. Got it? Okay. You're not God. Me neither. He's God, and we're not. Remember, the two things are true. Number one is what? Say it.
There is a God.
Number two?
I'm not him.
Okay, as long as you figured that out, that there is a God and you're not him, that kind of starts the whole issue that we face. But now remember, God created man in his image, but from the moment that he created him, from that moment forward, man has done everything that he could do to create God in his. From the time that God created us in his image, from that moment, we've done everything that we could possibly do to create him in ours. So here we have it. He said, my son, attend to my words. Attend to them. That's what gives your attention. That's what it gets. My words need to get your attention. He said, incline your ear to my sayings. To my sayings, mine. He said, let them not depart from before your eyes. Keep them always in front of you. He said, and then keep them in the midst of your heart, because they're life to those who find them. Inside of God's word is every bit of life that you need. It's not being able to just see it, because there are 1,189 chapters. There's 750,000 words in the Bible. It's there. But that's not it. Is that in every one of the things that you see, there is a key hidden inside there. And he said, now look, keep them in the midst of your heart. For their life to those who find them, and their health to all of their flesh. The problems that people have that they don't even realize is that they have flesh problems. These flesh problems have to do with my pain, I'm hurt, you hurt me, you lied to me, you this to me, you that to me. And what happens is that his words are health, where all that sickness tries to find its way inside you. He said there in verse number 24, verse 24, he said this. He said, let your eyes look right on, or verse 25, let your eyes look right on and let your eyelids look straight before you. So now we see that to be true. One thing I don't want to pass up that I did pass up, and that was this, is that I want to talk to you for just a second before I go to number two about reality. One of the biggest problems that people have, especially in the church, is reality. They don't deal with reality. Reality is a huge, huge deal. They lie to themselves all the time. And having done what I've done for as long as I have, I can tell you this, is that I meet people, or let's say I met people when they were 25, and now they're 63, and they're the same. And the challenge that they have is they lack reality. They don't deal with where they're at. They pretend to others that they're at a different place that they are. I almost wanted to have a name tag. And on this name tag, I thought about this is what I wanted to do. I wanted to write this name tag and say, hello, you remember those ones that kind of stick on? Those ones there that you don't want to put on any of your clothes, that you just end up happening that way. And I thought of, hello, my name is Reality. Have we met? Because most often people have never met reality. They don't meet reality until they finally come to a place where they are willing to stay somewhere long enough to not only have someone tell them the truth, but to tell themselves the truth. There's so much to say about this. Value. What is my value? My value isn't yesterday. My value is what I bring to you for tomorrow, not what I gave to you yesterday. So there is a small truth of, well, what have you done for me lately? Because my value is going forward. My value isn't going backwards. So number two, it's the law of value. The law of value. Now this law here, and you have to remember that laws really, and there are about six or seven different definitions of the word law, and none of them are really true. They cannot define law. Other than, it just so happens to be words that are spoken or written that become binding in any society. Without laws in a society, there's utter pandemonium. Without two people agreeing with what they agree about, it just doesn't work. Because one person will keep them and another person will not. And the moment, and you have to remember that your life is really determined not by the person who keeps the law, it's really determined by the person who breaks it. Thus, it must tell you that your life is not determined by the greatest people you know. It's really dismantled by the worst people that you know. You understand that? That's why you must minimize the wrong people. So number two is the law of value. And the principle that we have for the law of value is this, is that any or whatever value that you place, can you give me that please? The value you place upon anything in life is immediately revealed by the price that you're willing to pay for it. If you want to know what a person values, just see what they're willing to pay for it. A person can tell you that they value you and not be willing to pay the price that it costs to be near you. Know that that's true. Now, let me just explain something to you about reality. Reality is not happy. But now remember, happiness is a choice. Sadness is a choice. Wellness is a choice. Depression is a choice. All of these things are choices. I choose to be happy. You cannot, I will not give you the power to determine whether I'm happy or unhappy. Must never put that over into the hands of someone else. And so I understand that. But there's something about truth. And remember this. In life, there is nothing more depressing than truth. The most depressing things you'll ever hear in your life aren't children that are molested or taken away. The most depressing thing that you will ever hear has to do with finally telling yourself the truth. The most sober that you will ever be and in contact with yourself will be the moment that you tell you what the truth really is. So the value that you place upon anything is immediately revealed by the price that you're willing to pay for it. There was a woman in Luke chapter 7. This woman was the woman who actually was kind of an outsider, but she was a person who must have been allowed. She had to be allowed because people that were outsiders have to be able to see what's going on inside of this religious man Simon's home. And he came into, or he actually had this courtyard, and everyone was allowed to be able to come into the courtyard to see this dinner guest that he had had. His name was Simon, and he asked Jesus to come for dinner. And he said to Jesus, she came in, and she broke the spikenard. She poured the perfume upon Jesus, on his feet. She washed his feet with her tears, dried them with her hair, and then anointed him with this perfume. Judas got upset. He didn't see Jesus as valuable. He said, why couldn't we have taken this perfume and given it to the poor? Jesus said, the poor you have with you always, but not me. Never forget that. The poor you have with you always. There's always something to do, but you rarely ever have the opportunity to do what you can do with others. Secondly, is that Simon says to himself, if this guy was really a prophet, he would have known who this woman was. He would have known that she was really someone who shouldn't be touching him. And Jesus said to him, he said, Simon, he said, I have something to ask you. And Simon said, feel free to speak, Jesus. He said, there were two men. One owed his master 50 days' wages. The other one owed his master 500 days' wages. When neither one of them could pay him back, he decided to be able to forgive them both. Which then, Simon, do you believe? Which one of them do you believe loved his master more? And Simon said, well, the one that was forgiven more. And Jesus looked at the woman and said to Simon, from the time I came into your house, this woman has not ceased washing my feet with her tears and drying them with her hair. She has not stopped speaking to me words of love. She anointed me for burial. Simon, since I've been here, you haven't given me anything to wash my face with, or my feet. You gave me no cloth to do anything. He said, Simon, her sins, which are many, are forgiven. For he that has been forgiven much loves much. Because the value that you place upon anything is revealed by the price you're willing to pay for it. She was willing to pay everything. He was willing to pay nothing. There's nothing more depressing in life than the truth. And Simon just came to the truth. Simon, there are consequences. Her sins, which are many, are forgiven. You will never see Simon. Number four. Was that number three? That was number two? Well, let's do number three then. The law of discipline. Interesting, the law of disciplines. Discipline is not a negative word. People have the idea, whether it be with children or whether it be in any type of sporting preparation or in home life, people have the idea that discipline is negative. Discipline isn't negative. Discipline is what sets parameters. Everything has disciplines. Everything. A business has disciplines. A marriage has disciplines. Sports have disciplines. Churches have disciplines. Christianity has disciplines. Everything has disciplines that it does. All that disciplines mean are the things that we do consistently in order to become successful at what we do. That's a discipline. When you discipline a child, you are not punishing the child. You are showing them the right way to do something. That's why when a person says disciplining in anger, that's because you weren't disciplining them, you were punishing them. So you have to understand that discipline has nothing to do with anger. Discipline is what you do in order to cause success. In any area of life, what sets two people apart inside of any room are the disciplines. One person hears something great. Another person sits there and, it's kind of like a guy going over to a seminar. He spends $5,000 to go to the seminar. Tom will understand this. $5,000 to go to a seminar. What it is he spends $1,500 for his hotel room. And after he's got the $6,500 in it, after the seminar starts, he's sitting outside of the hall deciding which one of the classes for the seminar that he wants to go to. Because there's no disciplines in it. Can you imagine a guy investing $7,500 or so into a seminar or a conference that he never even looked to see what he wanted to learn out of it? There was absolutely no, you can invest as much as you want, but unless you have the disciplines to be able to extract out of what you learn, you will have gained nothing. So are we number three or number four? Law of discipline. And the law of discipline says this, number three, is that discipline is an act of doing what is necessary or doing what I must, even when I would rather be doing something else, or even when I'd rather be doing anything else. Not just something else, but anything else. Discipline is the act of doing what is necessary, even during the moments when I'd rather be doing something other than that. Our scriptures that we have concerning that are these. In Proverbs chapter 6, it talks about the ant. And can you imagine that God actually uses the ant to be our instructor? That's pretty cool. Never used an uncle to be our instructor, just ants. He said, "Hey, go to the ant, you slugger. Go to your aunt, you lazy bum." He said, "Go to your aunt and consider her ways." That's why he said to her. "And be wise, which having no guide, no overseer or ruler, gathers its food in the summer and or provides meat in the summer and gathers her food in the harvest." Verse 9, he said, "How long will you not discipline? When are you going to tell yourself the truth? When are you going to arise out of sleep? When are you going to be honest with you about where you are?" Then, another one that a scripture that we use is this. Here in Proverbs 25:28, it says, "He that has no rule over his own spirit is like a city that is broken down and without walls." thinking, a city that is broken down. That meant that it was already built at one time. So this city that was already built without disciplines will be broken down without walls. Now, let me ask you a question. Does that have anything to do with God loving you? Does God love you still?
Yes.
Does God still have grace in your life?
Yes.
That's true. But do people that God has grace for fail? So if that's true, then that's what we need to think about. The disciplines. Because discipline is an act of doing what is necessary when I'd rather be doing almost anything else. I just would do anything else rather than do the thing that I have to do. And then, number four, then, is the law of determination. Determination. Being determined. Being determined. Not distracted, but determined. Here's our principle. There can be no lasting results without sticking to something. There are no results unless you stick to it. Unless I stick to something, I can't get the results that I'm looking for. In the book of Galatians chapter 6, verse number 9, the Apostle Paul writes these words and he says this, "And let us not become weary in well-doing, for in due season we'll reap if we faint not." I like what the Phillips translation says. It says this, it says, "And let us not grow weary in doing what is right. For unless we throw in our hand, the ultimate harvest is assured." You mean unless I get bluffed thinking that life has a greater hand than I've got. Unless I get deceived into believing that my efforts won't pay off. So he said, let us not become weary in well-doing. For unless we throw in our hand, the ultimate harvest is assured. And then in the book of Isaiah, chapter 40, verse number 31, the Bible says, "But they that wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles." Now, it's an interesting thing about eagles and an interesting thing about them mounting up. When you see... Let's just use a hawk for as an example, because a lot of things are very, very similar. And you see them up in the sky, and they really fly a lot higher than any other bird. And you can see hawks around here. We have several of them. At least you might have one or two in your neighborhood. But what you see is you see all of a sudden when they begin to just glide. They're not flying anymore. They're not flapping their wings. What you see is you can almost barely see them. But you see that they're in locked position. When an eagle mounts up in his wings lock into place. And he said here that we that wait upon the Lord will not only renew our strength. Speaking of how that when an eagle molts. Do you understand molting? An eagle molting? How many of you do not know what an eagle molting is? What an eagle molting is this, is that as an eagle begins to age, what happens is that his eyesight begins to grow dim. He doesn't see like he could. His beak begins to be dull. His talons, which are his claws, they're no longer sharp. They have become smooth. They're still there, but they're smooth. And what an eagle does, and it is his most vulnerable time in life. Everyone say vulnerability.
Vulnerability.
You see, until we come to the moment of vulnerability, you'll never be able to grow. Vulnerability means that you're no longer producing or covering up with fig leaves and producing aprons in your life over the things that you're trying to hide behind. Let it be the very thing. I told a person this morning up at Pastor James' church, that a gentleman that came and spoke to me after the service, he told me about his difficulties and how he fell and how he was in the ministry and how he his life all those years ago, about 15 years ago, how he was this well-known music minister. And he just said, I just want God to use me. Can you imagine? 15 years of shame that you could never get away from. I said, do you believe that God has forgiven you? He said, yes. And I said, how come you can't forgive you? Why do you punish yourself every day with something that God has already forgiven you for? Every day. You wake up, you open your eyes, and it's there. That quick. It's like a devil that was sitting on the edge of your bed waiting for you to just open your little peepers. Vulnerability. This vulnerability is where the eagle is at. When the eagle actually has this very, very dull beak, he has these talons that don't really work. He's getting to a place to where he can't catch anything because he can't see anything in the water anymore because he's got these things over his eyes, and his feathers really are now coming worn out. What does he do? He goes to the highest mountain, where he is by himself. And he begins to take his beak and what's left of it and begin to rip out all of his feathers one by one. And then, after he has none left on all of his body, he then begins to bite and rip off all of his claws. He has no feathers and no claws. And then he beats his beak until he breaks it off. And he now is completely and utterly vulnerable. He has no defenses whatsoever. And he lays there on that mountaintop in front of the entire world. And what begins to happen is that one day his talons begin to grow back. His beak begins to protrude out of his face, and his feathers begin to grow again. And this time, no longer are they worn out. He is better than he was when he was new. And so Isaiah gives us this story and this picture when he tells us that they shall mount up with wings like the eagles, and they shall run, and they'll not be weary, and they'll walk, and they'll never faint. I cannot tell you what all of this has meant to me. How many times I've had to go alone and rip out everything I trusted in and rebuild it with the very things, no longer how that they got confused by what happened with people, but to always remember that I just went back to what I believed in the beginning. You see, the law of discipline has to do with doing what I must, even when I want to do anything except that. Because when you have to molt, you have to do it alone. You never get to do it in a crowd. Number five, the law of attitude. Interestingly enough, here's what it says, is that choose a good attitude because it is the first thing everyone sees about you. The Apostle Paul said it like this in Philippians chapter 4, beginning with verse number 11 in the Message Bible. He says, actually, he said, I don't have a sense of needing anything personally. You get to this point. The very things that are so important to people mean absolutely nothing to you. They don't mean anything. They don't mean anything. They only mean something to someone who believes that there's an identity within them. They mean nothing. Because once you have them in your hand, you think, I gave up all of my life for this? It's exactly like we're going to see the devil when we finally see him. Our response to when we finally see the devil will be this. You mean that this is the one who deceived the nations? This is what I was afraid of? This is what I let influence me to tell me I couldn't, to keep me from the one who told me that I can do anything? This one? So he said, actually, I don't have a sense of needing anything personally, really. He said, I've learned by now to be quite content whatever my circumstances. I don't care, he said. Verse 12. He said, I'm just as happy with little as with much. He said, it's no problem. Why? Because happiness is a choice. And so is suffering. So is discontent. So is depression. Well, you know, but you've never been depressed. You want to talk about depression? Well, you haven't been depressed in 35 years. Are you kidding me? I have been the living depressed. But I'll never tell you. People think, oh, well, you don't have any problems. Are you kidding me? If I gave you one of mine, you know what? It's not worth telling you. Because until you get there, you'll never know. You only think you know. So he said, here, I'm just as happy with little as with much. He says, with much as with little, really. He said, I found the recipe for being happy, whether full or hungry. He said, I found this recipe. Hands full or hands empty. He said, whatever I have and wherever I am. He said, I can make it through anything in the one who makes me who I am. I can make this. Some days you have a lot. Some days you don't have anything. One day you're happy, one day you're sad. What are you sad about? Well, yeah, but I don't have anything. Praise God, that means no one can take it from you. Can't take nothing from nothing. Well, yeah, but I'll tell you what. If I just had this, it was going to be better. Really? Well, what do we do with the scripture that says that when wealth increases, so do they that eat it? What are you going to do when you have 20 people on a rotation that are calling you for money because they think you have it? You know, if you don't have anything, you never need to tell anybody no. All you need to do is say, you know, if I could, I would. And really, believe me when I tell you, there's nothing
sarcastic about that. The truth of it is that when God begins to do things inside your life and you come to a place to where there is a little bit of an excess, you begin to feel a discontent inside you of what you know that God wants you to do with it. And you search. You see, if you don't have enough to be able to get by, you don't ever have to worry about it. But when God begins to give it to you, now what are you going to do? Now we find out if you're generous or you're not. Now we find out if the things that you say that you believe are real or they are not. And he said, now I can do. Whether I have a lot, whether I have a little, it doesn't really matter. It's all the same. It's only with people that that matters. It doesn't matter with God. As a matter of fact, God will give you something to reveal who you are, not to reveal who he is. Oh, but I don't have enough to get by. Well, then there's only one way to go. And that's up. Stop playing for this life. It means nothing. You will come to the end of it and ask yourself why you traded all of your time and all of your love and all of your hard work and everything for it. The only thing that matters is what heaven wants. Because that's the only place that you will ever feel any true contentment. Any real contentment. Did you learn anything? Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Thank you, Father. Thank you for the word of God. Thank you for your kindness, for your mercy, and for your love. Say this after me, Father. There are laws that govern me. I am one who chooses what you desire to be chosen. I choose to be happy. I choose to be real with myself, with you, and then with others. Thank you, Father, for leading me and guiding me into your words. And then may I be able to tell myself what you have to say. And I can respond in the way you desire. In Jesus' name. Amen.